And then last time we have discussed about the statistical inference for one population proportion and one population mean. And then we have seen how we can use the traditional method and the p-value methods in making the decision for the hypothesis testing. And we know that we have another method called as the confidence interval method. And let us see how this confidence interval method differ to the first and the second method that we have discussed earlier on. Okay, can you all hear me clearly, class?
Yes.
Class? Okay. Now, when we deal with the traditional method, we know that we are discussing about the five steps in traditional method, beginning from the statement of your alternative and null statement, and then identifying which of the statement become your claim. Okay, so that will be your first step. And then what we do, we find the critical value. If the n is less than 30, for the case of population mean, if less than n 30, then we less than 30, we are going to use the t statistic. Okay, t critical value. Okay, for this case, if let's assume your n is greater than 30, then we use the z our critical value, and then we compute the test statistic, and then in the fourth step, we compare. Okay, if you are talking about right tail test, and if you know that this is your critical region, okay, and this is your z alpha, and then of course, if you have your test statistic fall in the non-rejection region, then we say fail to reject the null hypothesis. So this is where you say fail to reject null. If it falls within the rejection region, then we say reject null hypothesis. Okay, so and finally, in the fifth step, you are going to make conclusion. Okay, and then your conclusion will be based on the claim that you have in your first step. Okay, whether we will have to reject sufficient evidence or insufficient evidence to reject the null, or sufficient evidence or insufficient evidence to support your claim if it is in your alternative statement. And if you are using your p-value method compared to the first step on the traditional method, the one that differ would be in the second step and the third step. Okay, where in p-value method, we are going to use the what we call test statistic as our hint to get your p-value. So your z-test, if you look in your first step, your z-test is at the third step. Now it becomes the second step. Because we are using this z-value to find what will be the p-value. Okay, so from your z-test, if you are talking about left right tail test, okay, so if your test statistic, this is your z calculated or z test, and then we know that we need to find what is the probability here, which known as your p-value. Okay, and then we are going to compare this p-value with the alpha. Okay, so we know that alpha is the rejection region. Okay, so if let's say your alpha, if let's say alpha is denoted in green, so if your alpha somewhere over here, your alpha is at this region, means that, okay, so this is your alpha, then your p-value is smaller than your alpha, then what happened is that p-value smaller than alpha, we reject the null hypothesis. Obviously, because it is within the rejection region. We know that this is the rejection region. Okay, so because of that, okay, if your p-value is greater than, so means that let's say your p-value is greater than, let's say your z-test is somewhere over here. So let's say this is your z-test. Okay, is greater than the alpha. So let's say these are all the probability for this particular z. Okay, and this is your new p value. Okay, so obviously in this case, okay, your z test falls in the it is outside the rejection region, so that's why we fail to reject the null hypothesis. Okay, so that's how we make conclusion if we are using the p value method. And of course, the last part, conclusion, just the same as what we have in the traditional method. Now, the question is, how about the hypothesis testing and the decision is based on the confidence interval value? Okay, so it's actually simple, okay, as long as you understand the concept of how we make the decision whether to fail to reject now and reject now. Okay, let's say we are talking about hypothesis testing for single population mean. Okay, what are the conditions applied for performing hypothesis testing but using CI? Okay, there will be two conditions applied. The first one, it only applies for two tail tests. Means that in E2271, we only focus for two tail tests only. Okay, so means that if you have mu is greater than mu naught, no, this is not applied for two tail, for a confidence interval. The same as mu is less than mu naught, so this one also does not apply for confidence interval method of hypothesis testing, of only for this particular case. And the second one would be you are going to use the same sigma, same alpha. That will be the level of significance that you use in your CI is the one that you will be using in your hypothesis testing. Okay, how do we decide? Okay, so look at these two conditions. First and second. We fail to reject the null hypothesis if the hypothesized value, which is the hypothesized value, is included in the CI. So this is your CI. If your hypothesized value is inside the CI, then we fail to reject the null hypothesis. If the hypothesized value is outside the CI, so this one is inside. So the other one is outside CI. Okay, then we say we reject the null hypothesis. As simple as that. Okay, so I think I have reported okay. Okay, now the same goes to hypothesis testing using CI for one population proportion. Also apply for two tail test and using the same alpha. Okay, also the same way of making decision, fail to reject if the CI does contain the hypothesized proportion population. If it is not included in your CI of your proportion, then we reject the null hypothesis. Let's look at the example. The hypothesis testing also applied for two populations, but this one will be covered afterwards. Okay, let's look at the example that we have on in example 3.7. Okay, a sample of 50 internet shoppers, blah blah blah. We have discussed this several times. Okay, now how do we decide? If we go back to the statement of the null and alternative statement, we know that the claim is at the null statement. Okay, and we know that we need to decide using the CI. Then we need to calculate what will be the CI for this particular region. Okay, applying the correct CI, okay, so putting everything accordingly, okay, since in this case, the sample standard deviation is given from the sample, it's unknown sigma, okay, so your sigma is estimated using the sample standard deviation, that is 1100. So once you have calculated, you know that your CI has this particular value from 995.10 until 1604.90. Okay, now what is the hypothesized value? So if I put this in terms of the interval form, so 995.10, 1604.90, okay, 1500 will be, let's say at this area. Okay, so this is your mu naught, that is 1500. Okay, so since the hypothesized value is inside this I, then we say we fail to reject the null hypothesis. Okay, so we fail to reject the null hypothesis, and we know that our claim is at the null, so there is insufficient evidence to reject, okay, the claim. So that's how we make the decision for this particular question. Okay, any questions so far, class? Any question?
No, madam.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now we continue with the next summary. So if you look at your page, page 93, okay, you have in figure 3.14, you have this particular what we call summary. Okay, figure 3.14 on page 93 discuss in simple how you can make your decision based on the claim that is being defined, whether it is in your null statement or at the alternative statement. Okay, if your claim is at the null statement, okay, remember the null statement is the understood the assumed statement that always to be true, except your evidence say the other way around. Okay, so that's why the words that we always use for the claim at the null statement will always be to reject. Okay, it's either to reject, whether you have sufficient evidence or insufficient evidence. Cukup bukti atau tak cukup bukti. Nak tolak dia punya claim yang you define pada null statement. Okay, so if you, for example, our previous example just now, your claim is at the null statement, and then yet you fail to reject null statement, and then you fail to reject. So what happened? There is insufficient evidence to reject the claim. That's why you make that decision. Okay, you make that decision. What if your claim is at the alternative statement? What if you reject, or what if you fail to reject the null? Okay, so that's why if your statement of your claim is at the alternative statement, if let's say you reject the null hypothesis, okay, means that you have sufficient evidence to support your claim. Okay, the other way around would be if you fail to reject the null hypothesis, means that you have insufficient evidence to support your claim. So you can use this, okay, use this to what we call to see all the conclusion. For the question we have answered, okay, how all the what we call conclusion are being made based on the claim that belongs to null or alternative. Okay, any question so far for this part class? Any question? No. No, eh?
No, madam.
Okay, thank you. Then, if you look through your textbook on, if you go back to your textbook on page, if I'm not mistaken, yeah, on page 85. Okay? Page 85. There is subtopic under type 1 error, type 2 error, power of test. Okay, so what are these? So since we have discussed about the CI and hypothesis testing for one population, proportion and one population mean, I think it would be okay if I go through what do we mean by type 1 error, type 2 error and power of test. Okay, so this part is what we are doing using sample evidence. So this is our what we call test. Okay, sample evidence for testing. Now this is if let's say we consider the actual. Okay, so the actual, what happened in actual. Okay, so if let's say we reject the null hypothesis or we fail to reject the null hypothesis, what happened if we compare this particular decision with the actual condition? Okay, now what will be the actual condition given that the null is true? This is the first, and the null is false. Okay, now your decision reject the null knowing that the null is true. So probability of rejecting the null given that the null is true. So I'm referring to this. Okay, these underlined terms is reflected by the probability of rejecting the null hypothesis given that the null is true. You know that the statement you reject the null knowing that the null is true. Is that correct decision or wrong decision? It's a false decision, right? So that false decision is actually reflecting your alpha value. So if you are talking about your what we call null, so if you are talking about your H null, the one that you are testing, okay, the statement that you are testing. So if you are referring to your right tail test, this is your alpha. Okay, this is the probability of reject null given that null is true. Okay, which is wrong decision, okay, false decision. And then what else? What about 1 minus alpha, which is correct decision? Okay, so correct decision, okay, means that we are reflecting to your 1 minus alpha. What about if your alpha is your null is false? Okay, you reject the null. Okay, so let's say you have this, you have one, this one. Okay, you reject this. Okay, knowing that the null is true, okay, we say as false decision. Okay, now you have your null and then you reject knowing that your null is false. Okay, it's your correct decision. We reject null knowing that null is false, then it is correct decision lah. So here is probability of reject null given that null is false. That's why it is correct decision. So this is what we call as 1 minus beta. Okay, and then what is type 2 error? Type 2 error is when you fail to reject null given that null is false. You know that null is false, then you fail to reject. So again, this is a wrong decision and we call it as false negative. Okay, this is false negative, this is false positive. False positive is when you reject the null knowing that the null is true. False negative is when you reject the null, fail to reject the null, knowing that the null statement is false. So that is what we call false negative. So the power of test is what we call the correct decision when the condition given that rejecting the null when the null is false. Okay, so I'm not going to what we call further details about this discussion. I'm going to share with you this slide, and If we have example afterwards, we are going to discuss this again. Okay, so that will be some of the summary of type 1 error, type 2 error, and power of test. Okay, it actually, in terms of the 1 minus beta, so how does how can we describe them? Yes? So this is the way we can describe this particular situation. Okay, so let's say this is your null statement, okay, and this is your alpha, and this is your probability of reject null, given that null is true. It's wrong decision, right? False positive. Okay, false positive. Beta is what we call, beta is just now is your beta, right? False negative. Okay, so your beta. Your beta is actually the probability of fail to reject now. Now, given that your now is false. You fail to reject the statement, but yet you know that the statement is false. So that is what we call false negative. Okay, false negative. Okay, so you can see. The area of 1 minus so your area of 1 minus beta alpha would be from this so it would be from this part until alpha, so this is 1 minus alpha, and from this part to this is what we call 1 minus beta. Okay, so you don't have to memorize the diagram or the figure, okay? It just need to understand what is the concept of type 1 error, type 2 error, and everything. Okay? So that's all for this particular part. Do you have any question, class?